This is the second part of a CNN series. In this video, we will look at 1D convolution. 1D convolution can be used for sequence data such as time series and natural language data. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is generated by AI, text-to-speech. In the last video, we briefly looked at the basic concepts and main components of CNN. In this video, we will take a closer look at a CNN model using 1D convolutional layers. Let's take a look at how the one-dimensional convolutional layer works. Let's take a look at the structure of the input and output of a 1D convolutional layer. And we will also look at a one-dimensional pooling layer. Let's implement a custom 1D convolutional layer class from scratch. And we'll use this class to predict time series and classify MNIST images. This is a regression problem, and this is a classification problem. The final component of a CNN model, the feedforward network, performs regression or classification. Finally, let's classify MNIST images using Keras 1D convolution class. Again, 1D convolution is typically used for sequence data such as time series and natural language data, and the filters slide in one dimension. The structure of the input data X is as follows. The input data is mainly sequence data. The input data used in 1D convolution is three-dimensional. The first dimension is the batch size of the input data. The second dimension is the number of rows, which is the length of the sequence, N. The third dimension is the number of columns, which is the number of features or the size of the embedding vector, M. Padding can be added on the top and bottom. Apply multiple filters to the input data. Compute the cross-correlation or convolution between the input data and the filters. Cross-correlation and convolution were covered in the previous video. The filters are also three-dimensional. The first dimension is the number of filters, R. The second dimension is the number of rows, K, in each filter. For 1D convolution, the third dimension of each filter is M, which is equal to the number of columns in the input data. R and K are hyperparameters. Add biases to the results of the cross-correlation or convolution. The first filter, W1, scans the input data as it moves downwards. In this example, we set the stride value to 1. This will generate the first sub-feature map. This is the first column vector of the feature map. The expressions to find this column vector are as follows. The first column vector is obtained through the first filter W1 and B1, and the second column vector is obtained using the second filter W2 and B2. The expressions to find the second column vector are as follows. And the third column vector is obtained through the third filter W3 and B3. Therefore, the final feature map also has a three-dimensional structure. The first dimension is the batch size of the input data. The second dimension is expressed by this formula, where P and S represent padding and stride value, respectively. And the third dimension is R, the number of filters. This is the final feature map, which is the output of the 1D convolutional layer. This feature map is then fed into the next 1D convolutional layer or 1D pooling layer. Next, let's look at the 1D pooling layer. A pooling layer downsamples the output feature maps of the convolutional layer to produce new feature maps of smaller size. The feature map, which is the output of the 1D convolutional layer we looked at on the previous page, looks like this. Let's say the dimensions of the matrices are as follows. This feature map is a 6x5 matrix, excluding the batch dimension. Let's use a 1D max pooling filter of size 2, like this. This filter is applied to each column vector in the feature map. First, apply this filter to the first column vector of the feature map, and select the maximum value in the area covered by this filter. This will be the first element value of the downsampled feature map. And move this filter down. In this example, the stride value is set to 2. The maximum value in this area is 0.82. This will be the next element value in the downsampled feature map. Applying this filter to all column vectors in the feature map in this way gives us a downsampled feature map as follows. This is the 1D max pooling process. This feature map is a 3x5 matrix, excluding the batch dimension. This feature map can be fed into another 1D convolutional layer or into a feedforward network, as in this example. This feature map is reshaped into a two-dimensional structure and then fed into a feedforward network. The feedforward network performs classification or regression. You can also use 1D global max pooling, as in the example below. In this case, the size of the pooling filter is equal to the number of rows in the feature map. This filter produces a two-dimensional feature map like this. This feature map can be fed directly into a feedforward network. This is an example of a simple 1D convolutional neural network model using a 1D max pooling layer or a 1D global max pooling layer. Instead of a 1D max pooling layer, you can also use a 1D average pooling layer. Next, let's create a custom 1D convolution class from scratch. The class name is MyConv1D. The input arguments are the dimension of the input data, the number of filters, and the filter size. The input data has a three-dimensional structure like this. The first dimension is the batch size. The second dimension is the number of rows, n rows. And the third dimension is the number of columns, input dims. Filters also have this three-dimensional structure. The first dimension is the number of filters, and the second dimension is kernel size, the number of rows in each filter. And the third dimension must be the same as the third dimension of the input data. Create TensorFlow variables for filters and biases. Next, let's write a call function. This function returns a feature map like this. When the padding argument is set to same, the number of rows in the feature map is equal to the number of rows in the input data. For this, we need to insert padding. We will fix the stride value to 1. For the second dimension of the feature map to be n rows, the padding p must be kernel size divided by 2. compute the number of paddings to insert at the top and bottom in the input data, and add padding into the input data. Add padding only to the second dimension of the input data. The number of rows in the output feature map will be n rows. If the padding argument is not set to same, no padding is added. The number of rows in the output feature map is n rows minus the kernel size plus 1. Next, compute the cross-correlations as we move down the filters. Compute the cross-correlation between input data and filters and store the results in the list CC. Reshape the list CC to have the shape of the feature map. Next, let's write a code to predict a time series using the 1D convolution class we just wrote. Import the MyCon1D class. Generate a time series dataset. Let's generate two sine curves with different frequencies mixed with Gaussian noise as shown in the figure. Each curve consists of 3,000 data points. This data is a 3,000 by 2 matrix. This figure shows only the last 100 data points out of 3,000. This data has two features, x1 and x2. Each column vector is a sine curve. Our goal is to predict each time series into the future. We use this data to generate a dataset for a 1D convolutional network model. This dataset has a three-dimensional structure and is identical to that used in recurrent neural networks. Please refer to the first video in the recurrent neural network series for how to construct this dataset. Set the time series embedding size to 20. This is to represent the two features as a vector of size 20. Set the kernel size to 5 and the number of kernels or filters to 10. And set the pooling filter size to 10. Now let's build a 1D CNN model for regression. Create an input layer. The input layer receives three-dimensional data. Create a time series embedding layer. Create a MyCon1D layer. Padding argument is set to same. Apply ReLU activation function to the output feature map of the 1D convolutional layer. Then apply 1D average pooling to the results. Reshape the results to a 2D tensor and feed it into the output layer. Create and compile this model. Since this is a regression problem, we use the mean squared error loss. The parameters of this model are as follows. Fit this model to the training data. Next, let's use this model to predict future time series. Predict future values for the next 50 periods. This code is identical to the one used in recurrent neural networks. I will skip the explanation. The results are as follows. You can see that the mean squared loss decreases significantly as training progresses. The past time series and the predicted future time series are as follows. The blue and red are the observed past time series. The green and orange are the predicted future time series. Let's run this code. We got the following results. Next, let's predict a time series using Keras' 1D convolution class. Create a 1D CNN model. The parameters of this model are as follows and are identical to those of the previous code. The past time series and the predicted future time series are as follows. The results are similar to those of the previous code. Finally, let's classify MNIST images using a 1D CNN model. Read the MNIST dataset. Set the kernel size to 5 and the number of kernels to 20. And set the pooling filter size to 10. Now let's build a 1D CNN model for classification. Create an input layer. The input layer receives three-dimensional data. Create a MyConv1D layer. Since the padding argument is not specified, it defaults to valid. Therefore, no padding is added to the input data. Apply ReLU activation function to the output feature map of the 1D convolutional layer. Then apply 1D max pooling to the results. Reshape the results to a 2D tensor and feed it into the output layer. Create and compile this model. Since this is a classification problem, we use the cross entropy loss. Fit this model to the training data. And observe the history of losses. We measure the accuracy of the test data. Finally, let's check out some misclassified images. The accuracy of the test data is 0.9720. Let's check the misclassified images. The first image is actually a 4, but it was misclassified as a 9. Let's run this code. We got the following results. These can be easily implemented using Keras Conv1D class, but to better understand the 1D convolutional layer, we implemented a custom class. So far, we have looked at how 1D convolutional layer works and applied it to regression and classification problems. In the next video, we will look at 2D convolution.